Greetings. What this is a makeup class since we decided to start Wednesday as day one. This will be basically day two, except it's being recorded on Friday, and then it'll be put up on Moodle at least by Friday evening or over the weekend so that it can be put in the broadcast queue for tomorrow. Which would be like starting at 8 o'clock and then continuing till 12 noon. On the Moodle website, I have put up first the day one PowerPoints, the day one YouTubes, and an extra file that I called N-word mimetics. Now, as you know, the N-word, as it's called mostly by white people, because black people basically say like nigger. It has a history. There have been books written about it. But I want you to understand the concept of the word, and not only the word, but language itself in the context of memes. So I want to take the first part of this particular class explaining the PowerPoint that I put up on the Moodle website yesterday, and continue on. Now, this wasn't necessarily in the plan before we started delivering the class, but I think it's appropriate because I want you to have the tools to be able to take apart, deconstruct your world, and basically construct a better world, to make our world anew, as it were. So, go to slide. N-word mimetics, exploring and creating viruses of the mind. Now, meme is to gene, just like I explained the other day. A gene is the smallest unit of replicating physical life. Usually, it's a collection of DNA that's either carried by cells. And cells are individual biological entities. So, for example, in our body, every cell, except for the sex cells of sperm and ovum, basically every cell in our body has a complete genetic map. And so that's a distinct, and so bacteria also have a complete, distinct genetic map. So a gene is the smallest unit of replicating physical life. A meme is the smallest unit of replicating thought. So it could be a single word, a single concept, could be a number of different things. A meme is like a virus of the mind. So when we talk about things going viral, a meme, mimetics, is the idea where that going viral comes from. So a virus is a biological entity that is smaller than a cell that needs a living cell to replicate. So essentially what a virus does is it turns a cell into a virus factory. So whatever the function of the cell was before, the virus hijacks the cell's DNA and turns it into a virus factory. So this is how the AIDS virus works. This is how Ebola virus works. This is how herpes and smallpox and other viruses work. They hijack the cells of living beings and turn those cells into virus-making factories. A meme is basically like a virus of the mind, where an idea, a concept, can take over a undefended mind and turn it into a replicating mimetic factory. So, like genes, memes combine in the environment to become viral ideas. And this is a good thing and a bad thing, but we aren't assessing what memes are, whether memes are good or bad. A meme is successful or not, whether it's lethal or whether it's benign. So, meme rhymes with cream, smallest unit of replicating thought. Like a gene, smallest unit of replicating life. It's transmitted, the meme is transmitted through any cultural mode of communication. So word of mouth, handwritten letter, books, curriculum, the internet, any television shows, any human mode of communication. Memes, as the graphic suggests, combine to form viral ideas, which can also, like viruses, biological viruses, mutate over time or given diverse environments, hostile environments, positive environments. So some examples of what memes, what forms memes take, jingles, cliches, technology, gangs, and one of the ideas, this book, The Selfish Gene, was written by biologist Richard Dawkins in 1976. I first encountered it about 10 years later when I was a drug counselor in a local high school here, and being exposed to essentially white gang members who styled themselves after black gangs. So, you know, essentially, you know, I'm walking down the street, and the street happens to be 13th, and I'm, you know, I hear, "What's up, nigger?" And I turn around, you know, because I'm the only black person in sight, as far as I can tell, and it's two white kids talking to each other. And so I step to them and say, "What's up with what's up, nigger?" "Oh, no, no, not you. We weren't talking about you or to you. We were greeting each other." And I'm going, "Where are you from?" Because, you know, that style of communication is, you know, not only mimetically gang-related, but it comes from urban, mostly minority street gangs. You say, "What's up?" as a meme, you know. "What's up, my nigger?" And nigger in that context, where it's within a culture, is basically talking about shared oppression and that you're experiencing shared oppression. And so, for example, when people talk about, you know, when is it okay for white people to use the N-word? When you are subject to the same oppression and you understand the history of the word, maybe you use it in the privacy of your own home, that's safe. Out in public, probably not so much, because there could be some room for misinterpretation. So when I entitled this talk N-word Memetics, I was basically reporting to the gang task force that says, okay, what happens like when the gangs that you're targeting the gang task force towards are mostly white kids? So back to the story, the kids basically said, "What's up, nigger?" And they're, "Oh no, not you, we were talking to each other." And I said, "Where are you from?" And they said, "We're 7-4 Hoover Crips." Two white kids saying they're 7-4 Hoover Crips. Now, 7-4 Hoover Crips is a variation of an LA street gang. And I'm from LA, 48th and Dinker. So I said, "I know you are not from 74th and Hoover. Where are you from?" "Oh, Beaverton." "Yes, okay. So two white kids from suburban Portland, what do your parents do?" "My mom's a school teacher, my dad's a lawyer." "Okay, not the typical street gang Crip experience." So I said, "Somebody from 7-4 in Portland, actually a black street gang member, jumped you in, i.e. initiated you." So again, gangs are a meme that replicate. When I left Los Angeles in 1983, about 6 months before the crack epidemic started, the gangs, particularly Crips and Bloods, who are their own mimetic thread, and we'll discuss that later in the term, where they came from, the gangs were already multiracial. So it wasn't surprising to me that up the I-5 corridor, that gangs were organizing and selling drugs from LA up the I-5 corridor. So this was not a new phenomenon to me, being a drug counselor and working with gangs. So I said, so your mother's a school teacher, your father's a lawyer, somebody from 7-4 jumped you in, and they acknowledged that this was the case. So why did you get into a gang? And they proceeded to tell me, because this is two white kids who coming from upper middle class backgrounds, there was no gangs basically formed to meet certain people's survival needs, and these kids didn't have any threats to their survival. So, you know, I'm walking down the street, I hear "What's up, nigger?" I turn to them and go, "Who are you? And how are you using that word?" "Well, we're gang members, we're 7-4 Hoover Crips, and they're white kids." And so reporting this back to the gang task force, I said, if your law enforcement is telling you that 80% of the new gang recruits to what you're calling, what you used to call black style gangs, are now white kids, well, then you can't call them black style gangs if there's only one black person in it and the gang is mostly white. You can't say that it's a black style gang. "Oh, well, it's a style." Well, no, that doesn't work. "Oh, well, LA style." Like, that's different. But okay, so unpacking the meme. So these students, basically these, they're my students, and I asked them, okay, why did you join a gang? And they basically said that they were listening to rap music, and rap music was telling them a certain truth, that white culture was racist, it was classist, it was discriminatory, and that the only way that they could fight back was to join a gang and make a little money on the side, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Go, being a 7-4 Hoover Crip, a white 7-4 Hoover Crip is not exactly, shall we say, civil rights protest or appropriate civil rights protest, but we'll leave that for the moment. Go back to slide, if you will. So, lethal memes. Some memes are innocuous as a cold, as cold sores or flu, meaning they might be a little bit embarrassing, but you can kind of hide them. So, for example, that example I just used with the gangs, if they can, you know, I educated them to understand the N-word isn't really appropriate to use in public. You know, you should be careful about how you use that. There's a whole history about that. Whether you know the history or not, the history is in effect because of the meme, though I didn't even use the term meme with them. But I used the term meme with you in this class and the gang task force to basically say, okay, you guys, this phenomena is spreading virally, and so you're going to have to counter it virally, memetically, okay? So even the common cold can kill, and flu can be hemorrhagic, meaning that you can bleed out from it. The 1918 flu virus was like that. Millions of people died in a pandemic that grew across the planet. So some memes can be as quickly lethal as Ebola, or slowly lethal as hepatitis C or HIV. So, for example, I use the American Heritage Dictionary because dictionaries are definitely carriers and vectors of memes. They are the official version of and the official definition of what words mean. And the reason I use the American Heritage Dictionary is not because of the marketing ploy of naming something American Heritage, but it also has word origins, where they came from in the original language, and somewhat how they changed over time as part of the definition. So I use the American Heritage Dictionary, and the following are examples of dichotomous logic, that is opposing a logic composed of opposing binaries. So in order, And so these are, the graphic that I'm showing you are blow-ups of the American Heritage Dictionary, the college edition from, I believe, the late 80s, early 90s. Not that the definitions of the words have changed, but this is typical of the formatting of a paper dictionary. So, man, woman, white, and black. Now, what I'm doing as a strategy is showing you how I was also raised old school, which is also, for example, in the Spike Lee film about Malcolm X. When Malcolm is in prison, one of the characters shows him the exact thing, same thing that I'm showing you, where look at this dictionary. This is obviously composed by white people, and man and woman and white and black, and you know, these meanings, these words aren't just neutral, they are reinforcing a certain view of culture. So for example, with man, number 5, qualities of a man, a male human being endowed with courage, fortitude, etc., 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 womanish, effeminate, and weak. So in other words, within this culture, a man, a manly man, is, you know, courage, fortitude, assertive, etc., etc. And I, if I may use the vulgar term, the P word, the slang term for a woman's genitals, if a man shouldn't be weak or soft or a pussy, i.e. associating it with a woman being like a woman, effeminate and weak. Now, this is the dictionary. This is not, I'm not making this up. This is in every dictionary. And what it tells you about the culture and the meme is that obviously this culture doesn't have women warriors. Or if it does have women warriors, or if women can be strong, courageous, etc., it doesn't support that idea. White, pure, unsullied, fair, generous, decent. It actually has a reference, which was a Richard Pryor line, in which he said in a movie, wow, that was mighty white of you, meaning not, it wasn't a compliment, but he was like, okay, you're kind of like being oppressive and racist here. Yeah, that was mighty white of you. Like, that was mighty nice of you. But no, that was mighty white of you. And they incorporated that mistakenly into this definition by saying that white was fair, generous, and decent. And mighty white of you was indicative of that. A white lie. Diplomatic or well-intentioned untruth. So it's a lie, but it's a white lie, which is probably an opposite of a black lie, which is, you know, stinky and dark and meant to deceive. But a white lie is diplomatic. A white list, a list of people considered who are worthy of approval or whatever, as opposed to a black list of people who are basically considered disgusting or, you know, disapproving. Let's see, they actually have within that particular list the white man's burden, which is the supposed responsibility of white people to rule the planet, rule over ethnic minorities. And then finally, black, evil, cheerless, depressing, wicked, angry. So let's look at these words. So within the American Heritage Dictionary, you can basically do this with either the American Heritage Dictionary or other dictionaries. This is, again, basically an expansion of those. So number 5, a male human being endowed with qualities such as courage, strength, and fortitude considered characteristic of a man. And of manhood. Then woman, an adult female human being, women collectively, womankind, woman is wise, feminine quality or aspect, a maidservant, a mistress, a paramour, womanhood, the state of being a woman, woman's nature, womankind, womanish, effeminate, and characteristic of a woman, effeminate and weak, womanize, womankind, etc., etc. So obviously, in this particular this construction, the American Heritage Dictionary, women are not necessarily considered strong. White, an achromatic color of maximum lightness, the complement or antagonist of black. Now, complement means it goes with and it supports, or antagonist of black. The other extreme of the neutral gray series, et cetera, et cetera. The albumen of an egg, the white of an eyeball, a caucasoid, often white, so when we get into race, right? So a white lie, a diplomatic or well-intentioned untruth, white collar, of or pertaining to workers who are salaried or professional, whose work usually does not involve manual labor, and who are expected to dress with some degree of formality, like a suit and tie, et cetera, et cetera. The complement also of pink collared workers, who basically women who work in a professional environment. So, white collar work, white lie, diplomatic or well-intentioned untruth, a white list, a list of persons of an organization considered worthy of approval, white-livered, cowardly, white magic, or incantations that are practiced for good purposes as opposed to black magic, white mahogany, white man's burden, the supposed responsibility of the white people to govern the non-white people of the world, from a poem by Rudyard Kipling, which we will discuss at a later date when we're in the time period, because we are discussing that time period when the white man's burden was written. So that's white. Black. Being of the darkest achromatic visual value, producing or reflecting a comparatively little light and having no predominant hue. Let's see, when we're talking about race, often black, belonging to the ethnic group, having dark skin, especially negroid, dark in color, face black with anger, soiled as from soot, dirty, evil, wicked, black deeds, cheerless and depressing, gave him a black look, black thought, often black, attended with a calamity or displeasure or disaster. And then there's other things like blacklists, and I could go on about the number of negative connotations of black bliss, black magic, but what I wanted to call your attention to is a term called black amour, a dark-skinned person, especially an African Negro, black and Moor. So when Shakespeare refers to Othello the Moor, Moor literally is a Greek and a Roman word, Greek and Latin word, meaning black. And so if Othello's a blackamoor, or Europeans refer to someone as a blackamoor, they refer to someone as a black person. So when Joseph Haydn was referred to by the Prince of Austria as a blackamoor, and this instant, basically he's identifying him as a black person. And when that quote was used in the context of saying Beethoven had more of the Moor in his features than his teacher. So it's basically saying that if Haydn was called a blackamoor and Beethoven was darker than a blackamoor, than Joseph Haydn, then he was also black. Not what he's being portrayed as. So white people referring to a person of color in Germany being black. And white people are saying that. But the negative connotations of the word black were being at least suspended for Beethoven. So when we talk about word trees, place names, pride, slur, slang, we're basically talking about a mimetic transmutation, a mimetic mutation that occurred with the N-word that started out relatively neutral. So first of all, it was a place name, Niger, if we use the French pronunciation, or Niger, after a river in Africa. Nigeria, which is a country. Africa, which is the Greek name for that continent, which means land of the blacks. So when we talk about place names and concepts, Al-Kabulan is the indigenous name for the continent of Africa. Al-Kabulan means land of the blacks. Africa in Greek is a Greek word, means land of the blacks. Kemet, which the Greeks termed Egypt. Kemet is what it was referred to in the indigenous among the Kemetians. And Kemet means land of the blacks. Egypt means land of the blacks. Ethiopia means land of the people with burnt faces. So we see a pattern, a mimetic pattern here, right? So Niger, so the place names, Niger, Nigeria, Africa. Niger is a person from a place. Niger is a person from Africa. In German, which as a language transformed or mimetically influenced English, because many of our English words came from the German. For example, like poltergeist. Geist means ghost or spirit. Poltergeist is a noisy spirit. Our word for hungry started from the German. I coined a meme. I'm a maker of memes. Hungry Geist. That is a hungry ghost, a spirit that basically creates addiction. So, Niger is a person from Africa. Niger in German, N-E-G-G-E-R, German means also a place, a person from Africa. And it's a term of respect, because if we basically drop down to looking at Latin, suert in Latin from the Romans means dark. Swarthy, which is in English in the American Heritage and other dictionary, dark complected, or basically a dark color. So for example, when a kiddie biography of Beethoven published in 1976 refers to Ludwig Beethoven as swarthy, that means he's dark. And since Germany is not a tanning destination, he's a black person being born in Germany. He's not the only one. So when we talk about Schwarz, which is German for black, Schwarzkopf, black head, Schwarzmann, black man, Schwarzenegger, which literally translated from Old High German means black and from Africa. And Arnold actually admitted that his ancestors in Austria were partially black. That's where the name came from. It was a term of pride. They were proud that they were black and from Africa. Now, in English, if the German starts as Niger, and that's a prideful place name, Then, once it translates into English and the meme of racism starts taking hold, then the transformation of Nagar being a prideful place on identification, so many people call themselves Schwarzenegger, Schwarzkopf, Schwarzman, they were proud of their blackness and proud that they were from Africa, even though they were European citizens. So we, in England, we start getting this idea, and in English, we start getting this idea about nigger in English and American slang. Niggas, N-A-G-G-A-Z, where it becomes a pride of within hip-hop culture. So never ignorant, gaining goals always. So basically taking the negative concept and flipping it on its head, a la Tupac Shakur. In other languages, Abba or Abyssinian, so a Russian name for a black person. Abakidze, which was a proper name for a particular person. Arab, Arapov, Aksakov, Chimon Afrikanovich. These are all names for black people who made the trading. Shimon Afrikanovich was, for example, a historical black man who had a trading relationship with the Russians about 1000 AD. Moor, Turk are also ancient names, archaic names for black people. Blackamoor in English, I've already explained that. And then when we talk about the slave trade, mulatto is it comes from a Portuguese slaver term. A mulatto is a first generation white black mix. Then, just like I was talking about, where millions of Europeans were enslaved to trade horses and breed horses, and they had to keep track of a purebred animal to a quarter horse, to an eighth horse. Well, in order to make a quarter horse, you have to understand what a quarter is. So basically, a purebred is bred with another horse, and then another horse, another generation produces a quarter horse. And the reason I'm talking about that is same thing was done in slavery, basically to be able to make different levels of discrimination possible. So mulatto was a first generation black-white mix. Quadroon was a second generation, so 1/4 purebred African. Octoroon, 1/8 purebred African. And then we have the high yellow and red bone, which basically is different colors within black people, where a mulatto could be high yellow, or a person mixed with native, as I am, basically the red shows up, for example, my Choctaw cheekbones or whatever. But red bone is the African-American term for somebody that traces their lineage to Native Americans. So language is a virus. So as you can see, language is itself a carrier for memes because of its seminal viral nature, as complex recursive instructions and knowledge storage. So what I mean by that is language is a virus. It basically starts from a certain point of view and then mutates. So complex recursive means it repeats, but sometimes the mutation also gets repeated, so that a thing that might have started out as a positive or neutral place name then becomes an ethnic slur. And a racist act can also kind of lose the racial context, especially as it travels from different cultures. So whether it's blackface, tar baby, red skin, whatever. These are all memes that started out as ethnic slurs that have lost some of, probably not lost their power to hurt, but much of their historic context has been lost or forgotten. So it's vibrational, which means that it also carries with it the history, whether you acknowledge it or not. So it transmits everything that vibrates, sound, light, thought, magnetism, and other forces, and also kind of like the invisible weight of history in terms of the language being a virus. So whatever patterns the perceiver can perceive, and of course, those things that they cannot perceive. So for example, an ethnic slur, which wasn't an ethnic slur in its original context because it was a story. Another name for black people, equivalent to nigger, is tar baby. So a white therapist in Eugene, about a decade ago, used the term speaking of an African-American client and a family being in a tar baby situation. Now, that was spoken in front of a black employee of Lane Community College who was also doing their internship, their master's degree internship in this counseling organization. And she immediately objected, said, don't use that word. Like, I don't hear you using, you know, white families. I've never heard you use white families being in a tar baby situation, and they're in the exact same situation as this family, i.e. substance abuse and recurring substance abuse. So if you're not going to use the term tar baby with white families and you're only using it specifically with this black family, that's an ethnic slur, a tar baby situation. Oh, they said, well, it's not a racist term. No, she said, I'm telling you, it is a racist term. I'm from the South. It is a racist term, just like the N-word. Believe me. Well, they didn't believe her. They pointed to the dictionary. And then, because there was internet in 2006, they actually searched in Wikipedia the word tar baby. Now, here's why I have issues with the veracity of internet-based sources, though I will use them for convenience so that you know what I'm talking about. But here's why you should be suspicious. Both the dictionary definition and the Wikipedia definition led with the African trickster tale, which generated in its culture, in the African culture, does not have a negative connotation about the word black. Does not. So the African trickster tale was about, for example, Brer Rabbit. Okay, Brer Rabbit was like the African equivalent of coyote. And what coyote does in Native American culture is coyote is basically immortal and does the exact stupidest thing and teaches you how to do the right thing by doing the exact stupidest thing that gets him killed, but he comes back. And by that way, he's teaching you how to do the right thing through coyote's example. So Brer Rabbit lives in the Briar Patch, which you can think of as a very hostile environment that his enemies can't get through, and he can get inside, so it's like blackberries, the Briar Patch, right? So his enemies set a trap for him. They make a figure out of tar, which is black, and they give him buttons and a coat and stuff like that, but of course he can't speak. So Brer Rabbit finds this tar baby, and he says, hey, what's up? And the tar baby, of course, doesn't say anything. Hey, what's up? Doesn't say anything. You know, just like black people will greet each other, give each other the nod, say, what's up, what's happening, what's good, you know, hey now, whatever. And you basically are supposed to respond in kind, either a nod, what's up, very well, thank you, how are you, whatever. The tar baby doesn't say that. So you think you're better than me? Brer Rabbit says, you think you're better than me? And then he slaps him, which means he hits the tar baby and his hand gets stuck. Wait, let go. Hits him with the other hand, gets stuck, tries to kick him. Now he's completely entrapped. And so the West African tale is basically to say, keep your cool, even if somebody slights you. Keep your cool. Don't lose it. Very basic, right? Keep your cool. Even if your enemies provoke you, keep your cool. Now, that's the tar baby. That's the story of the tar baby. So when the Microsoft Dictionary on my Macintosh talks about tar baby but doesn't talk about the ethnic slur, when Wikipedia leads with the African trickster tale and then ends with certain people think that the use of the word tar baby is an ethnic slur, and then it cites The Atlantic magazine, which is not an arbiter of black culture. Now, at that time, the movie 42 hadn't come out, and the movie 42 was about Jackie Robinson, the first black man in Major League Baseball, and one of the people that uses an ethnic slur calls him a nigger, calls him a tar baby. Now, it's an ethnic slur, and people my age know tar baby is an ethnic slur. People of the therapist that was in training from the South know it as an ethnic slur. But white constructions, of which the internet is one and the dictionary is another, basically leave out the racial content. They do, right? So that's why, you should basically understand that many of these things travel underground. Language being a virus still carries meaning, and it's often the original meaning, which doesn't always get lost. It often gets lost because people don't want to remember the unpleasant stuff. Back to slide. So language is a virus. Logic is a means of reasoning to an answer. So a meme doesn't have to be true. It is either successful or not. Successful in replicating or not. It doesn't have to be true. Logic is a means of reasoning to an answer. The answer does not actually have to be true. It just has to be an answer that seems true within the logic system being studied. And there's different logic systems, and we'll explore that when we talk about axiology. So, for example, the meme of all men are created equal in the Constitution and Declaration of Independence. But in the Constitution, it says white men are superior to all others. So all men are created equal. Does that mean all male human beings? Or does it mean rich white men only? In the context of the Constitution, it means rich white men only. All men are created equal. And in the Constitution, it says white men are superior to all others. So in that statement, which can be interpreted mimetically in many different ways, basically I've named the different contexts that it has meaning. All those meanings simultaneously. Is it true? And does the language it framed and the language that it's framed in support the conclusion based on, say, for example, the dictionary, which could be edited of its racial context? Okay? Who is doing the defining? And that's one of the things you look at with mimetics and within the language of the dictionary. Where did the word come from? What did they mean? And how has that meaning changed? Now we might say all men are created equal, but by that we also mean all human beings, which is a definition within the dictionary. If you remember, if you read a dictionary that basically talks about all men are created equal, well, the use of the masculine pronoun is supposed to be generalized, so it's also considered to be inclusive of women also, but it's kind of archaic. That means it was used in ancient times or, you know, centuries ago, but has changed meanings or mutated meanings since then. So who is doing the defining? So the hero is the teller of the tale is not the same as the winner writes the history, though you could interpret it that way. In its African context, it basically says everybody has a story and everybody tells the story to make themselves look better, but you also need to know that everybody might not have the same view of what's going on. Not just the winners of a conflict. All my relations is not the same as we the people. So when we talk about, and when I talk about indigenous democracy before 1492, all my relations does not only mean all human beings, it also means the natural world, animal, plants, rocks, and the invisible world, the spirits, not only of human beings, but of nature. And that everybody's supposed to be in a relationship with that in an indigenous democracy. That is the culture that produced the longhouse, of which we have one. All my relations means everybody. Everybody, every human being has a voice in the government. Not just rich white men, obviously, because it's indigenous. But all my relations is not the same as we the people, because we the people originally meant the only people who were people, were considered people, voting citizens, were rich white men. So the memes have to be unpacked from their origin. You have to understand how they began and how they mutated to the present day. So we've come to memes and mimetic engineering. So if a meme is a virus of the mind, which can infect an open mind, and a unprepared mind, and begin replicating, as the smallest unit of replicating thought, a meme can have an influence beyond its size, just like a virus can have influence beyond its size. Memes are transmitted through any form of human communication, language, images, art, technology, beliefs, spirituality, religion. And once you understand the concept of memes, and you can detect memes in operation and cause a few of your own, just like I was doing with attempting to do with the gang task force, suggesting, here's a solution. And here, because it works with my people, and since your white kids are trying to follow and emulate black people, maybe we should give them a little black consciousness besides rap in terms of how they could do effective social transformation and social justice and equity work. Needless to say, when you're talking to the DA and the cops and stuff like that, and you're saying, these white kids are reacting to white culture. They don't like the racism in white culture. They want things to be more equal. And when you're talking to people that have a kind of interest in keeping things unequal, it doesn't go over very well. Anyway. Memes and mimetic engineering. So, isms are mimetic patterns of discrimination. So, isms, by which I mean an acronym like racism, sexism, classism, isms. It's a pattern of discrimination that is detectable and replicable and usually influenced by law and usually countered by law. So for example, in the U.S. Constitution, it replicates racism and sexism. In the U.S. Constitution, females are less than males, simply by all men are created equal. They could have said all people are created equal, but they didn't come from that. They weren't coming from that point of view. Blacks, and even specifying a number, 3/5 or 60%, are less than whites. That's in the Constitution. Rich are greater than poor. That's also in the Constitution. All men are created equal does not mean all human beings are equal under the U.S. Constitution as it originally was written. The Declaration of Independence was basically a statement from rich white men to the King of England saying, we ain't gonna follow you. We declare ourselves free. Well, what do you mean by we? All right? Countering a meme constructed of lies with the truth is a partial response. That is, creating a countervirus or an antivirus like you would with biology or within medicine. You also have to create an environment where truth memes will flourish. Because truth memes in an environment constructed of lies will basically perish by themselves unless you protect them or unless you create an environment where truth will flourish. So memes accrete, that means they combine and grow to become viral ideas and thus can take on a life of their own once they find new environments. Of course, they can change according to their environment. Memes aren't good or bad. They are successful or not. So as a virus evolves, it learns not to kill its host. Successful replication without being necessarily toxic. So, for example, our outgoing president, Barack Hussein Obama, born in America. So here's some memes that came out during his first campaign, Barack Hussein Obama. Barack Obama is a funny name. That means, that's a statement that actually kind of reflects on the speaker. Barack Obama is an un-American name. Now, that meme means that Barack is born in Hawaii, born in a state in the United States, he's a citizen automatically. An un-American name presumes that there are strictly American names, and by which they're saying American is white and whites only. This is a construct from the Constitution, the original Constitution. Only American citizens are white. Slaves are not white. Native Americans are not white. They're not citizens. They're domestic dependent nations, that is Native Americans. They're not American. But we have to control and shape them because they're dependent on us. Us Americans, which by the way, they meant white Americans. So Barack Obama is an un-American name. Barack Obama wasn't born here. He isn't a real American. Barack Obama pals around with terrorists. Barack Obama is scary. Barack is a socialist. He wants to redistribute your wealth and take your guns. Barack has the same middle name as Saddam Hussein. Osama Obama sounds like Osama. So these are memes that have associations. And countering them with truth or a little bit of expanded only neutralizes them partially if the listener is willing to listen to the truth. So many names, many people name their children after historical figures that they want to want the child to emulate. So Barak is actually a biblical name, and it's also in the Quran, because the Bible and the Quran both came from the same African context. In the book of Judges, the good general Barak, which also means, you know, faithful, strong, carried out a mission for the Queen of Israel. Hussein was Prophet Muhammad's grandson, who became symbolic of fighting oppression. Hussein went to negotiate a victory because his side had won. He was murdered, and then it took his followers 80 years to take that city back after 80 years of oppression. So Hussein, as the prophet's grandson, basically is a person who triumphs over oppression eventually. So when you name your kid Barak, honorable, faithful, Hussein, overcoming oppression, and Obama is basically a family name, that came from Kenya, which had a specific meaning, usually referring to a person, I think, who either was not crooked, but basically their leg was crooked, or they walked with a cane or a stick or something like that. So Barack Hussein Obama. So Joe Sixpack, the average real American, in other words, white American, beer drinking American, working class, not college educated, Joe Sixpack, and also Joe the plumber. Joe Sixpack doesn't just drink a six pack. And even if he did, medically speaking, he's a binge drinker, which means he could be a low-grade alcoholic. And you've normalized that by referring to somebody, Joe Sixpack, which, you know, could qualify him as having a substance use disorder, but the meme doesn't really examine that. Joe Sixpack, basically your average real American, in other words, white, beer drinking, working class, not college educated. Joe Sixpack probably could drink, when he knocks off work and says it's Miller time. Well, that meme, that association meme, associating beer drinking with leisure and excessive beer drinking, even though you don't examine that. Okay? So why is that a good thing, calling somebody Joe Sixpack and normalizing his addictive behavior? Joe the plumber, again, another figure from the campaign in 2007. Obama and the beer summit, you know, when he had that meeting with Henry Louis Gates, Skip Gates, and the cop that arrested Henry Louis Gates in his own home, after it was proven that it was his own home. So this is from Richard Brody's book. Richard Brody is a Microsoft millionaire, and he talks about Viruses of the Mind. That's the name of his book. And in this book, he talks about memes, and he makes the construct that he's creating is itself a meme. So a distinction meme, for example, is like categories, labels. Strategy memes are situational cause and effect beliefs. So cause and effect is also the name of a logic called here that computers and other people who are working on problems call a heuristic. And heuristic is based on if-then logic. If this happens, then this is what you do. So a strategy means if-then. If this happens, so for example, driving. You come to a red light and you're making a right turn. Stop and then turn. Stop because you're at a red light and turn, make a right turn. So coming to a four-way stop, you wait for all cars ahead, then go. A traffic circle, go counterclockwise. Then also a driving strategy meme, you see a cop, slow down. Drive casually. So with what's called the meme that's called a California glide, when you come to a red light or a stop sign, you slow down and then you make the turn without stopping. But legally, you're supposed to stop. But there are this that meme concept of a California glide. Additionally, I am inadequate. I am not enough. I am unable to have an impact on my world or control my impulses or feelings. Feelings are dangerous. Avoid them. External world gives me what I lack. And image is everything. These are actually addictive memes. Association memes basically link two or more memes. So, for example, the smell of wind on water, sunlight on grass or sand or rocks or skin, the flag with the military, American, winner, the best. Advertising memes, things like mom, apple pie, baseball, hot dogs, Chevrolet, sexy men, Diet Coke, sexy women, beers, computers, cars, Joe Camel, Youth Rebellion, supporting smoking, and then there's health memes, examples of health memes, good hygiene, you know, bathing every day, using soap and water, washing your hands after going to the bathroom, brushing your teeth, flossing, safe sex, I described that the other day. Safe sex is not just with barrier methods like a condom or other things like that. It's also knowing the infection status of your partner. Proper diet, what does that mean? Not fast food, rest, exercise. So these are all different types of memes, and you can see from this that memes are in our life all over the place, and there's a way of looking at that particular situation in terms of looking at memes from a positive point of view, from a negative point of view, from a successful point of view, or an unsuccessful point of view. So when I started applying this and expanding the concept by talking about assimilation. So assimilation is, if you look at the anthropological literature, because remember, our ethnic studies is multidisciplinary. Assimilation, when we're talking about culture, is negatively correlated with addiction. So we don't necessarily want people to assimilate into American culture because American culture is based on addiction and destroying cultures that do not support addiction. And we can get into that in a little while, in subsequent weeks. So for example, the meme of American culture being a melting pot, which is an industrial meme actually created by a Jewish man, a Jewish immigrant, who basically talked about America's the great melting pot, where he's talking about European immigrants melting into, losing their Italian, their German, their English, their Welsh, their Armenian, different national identities, and in America, they get melted down and poured out into the mainstream. So when George Bush talked about mainstream America, it was clear he was talking about white Iowa more than black South Central Los Angeles or Brooklyn. Mainstream America, i.e. the heartland, the homeland, the, you know, Joe Sixpack, Joe the plumber, both white men. Mainstream America, which is basically synonymous with white. So assimilation is basically erasing your culture of origin for a dominant culture norm. That is, you're not going to be Italian anymore, you're American, or even, you know, this is where we get the idea of hyphenated Americans, where people don't like hyphenated Americans. Why do you call yourself Italian American or African American or Latino American? Why don't you just call yourself American? Well, because the meme of American is white people. It's not inclusive. It's not. Because, and not because we created it that way. That was the history of the word. Mainstream American. So assimilation is basically erasing any trace of your ethnicity, your difference, and conforming to dominant culture norms like being an American, which means you don't refer to race. You don't talk about race. You don't talk about gender. Acculturation, next slide down, the slide, go back to slide if you would. Acculturation is kind of like the salad bowl. So these are definitely cultural memes that talk about degrees of acculturation and assimilation. So assimilation is erasing your original culture in favor of a dominant norm. Acculturation is retaining your culture, but taking on the cultural artifacts of another culture. So in a salad bowl meme, so in the melting pot meme is basically about assimilation. You melt down all trace of your ethnicity to become a mainstream America. In acculturation, which sometimes is used synonymously with assimilation in old anthropological literature, but it is actually a different thing. So acculturation is using the salad bowl meme, basically tomatoes remain tomatoes, though you can have several kinds of tomatoes. You can have several kinds of lettuce. Carrots remain carrots. Beets remain beets. Beets can color carrots. And then within the salad bowl, so everybody retains their individual identity, their individual culture, et cetera, et cetera. It doesn't matter whether it's a fruit salad or a green salad or a bean salad or whatever. The unifying culture is considered like the dressing that we all share. So that was a better model or meme, less toxic meme than the assimilation melting pot meme. What I was trying to basically talk about as a diversity trainer, training about gangs, training about different cultural paradigms, is that there's a viral mimetic paradigm in which an original culture can be replicated, but just like, if you can switch to me with a shot of looking at that, looking at the, so in any case, here you have the viral mimetic core, and the hexagram-like things is the viral coat, all right? So inside is a meme, a cultural meme that can actually mutate. And so, for example, if this were the virus or the meme, it attaches to the cultural cell and begins replicating. So very similarly, like if the original gang culture was black, but was basically organized for survival, it can be transmitted by any cultural mode. And by the two individuals that I contacted on the streets of Eugene that were white kids that called themselves 7-4 Hoover Crips, the only contact they, with black people that they had was one, the original person that jumped them into the gang, and MTV Raps. So they had they didn't read any black books. They didn't understand black history. They basically just said, I don't understand rap, but this is speaking to me in a particular way. So I'm going to emulate the style of dress, the language, the talking, you know, the drug dealing. But that's all I can see about gang culture, so that's what I'll emulate. So that becomes kind of like the protein coat of the virus. All you can emulate is the things that you can see outside, and then those things mutate once they become in a new environment. So a meme which might have started in South Central urban Los Angeles changes when it reaches Portland. And not just because of geography, but also because that's the nature of memes and culture. So, cultural paradigms. Memes for cross-cultural transmission. So, assimilation, the melting pot. Acculturation, the salad bowl. So, I might be a black man, but if I want to learn to eat Asian food, I might use chopsticks. Not all Asian cultures use chopsticks, but I can take on chopstick using, but still be a black man, right? So acculturation is you're taking on the cultural artifacts of another culture, and but still retaining your own culture. So for example, like again with eating, chopsticks, where is it polite to belch? So in certain cultures, they're waiting for you to belch so that you, it's a sign that you enjoyed the meal. If you don't belch, that could be an insult. All right, so assimilation. Erasing an emic is the anthropological term for inside a culture. Erasing an emic culture in favor of etic, that's a culture that's outside of your own, usually by conquest. Acculturation, taking on cultural artifacts and practices without erasing your own indigenous culture. Okay, so through diversity training cultural paradigms. The melting pot equals assimilation. The flame of freedom melts ethnic differences into mainstream American culture. Now, notice that really only works for European culture, because some black people and some people of color do not melt. They don't melt in terms of their appearance, though they might take on an identity that erases their ethnic culture. Like Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas, like O.J. Simpson. I'm not black, I'm O.J. Salad bowl, acculturation, taking on cultural artifacts and practices without erasing your own. Which fork is the salad fork? Chopsticks, etc. So culture is also a virus, okay, that adapts to its host, and its hosts adapt to survival conditions or survival in less than optimal conditions. Sometimes an old survival pattern is retained long after the harsh conditions have ended in terms of some parts of a meme might resist change. Okay? Or it fails to adapt to the conditions that are about to transpire. So, for example, Hopi prophecy predicted The Coming of Whites to Turtle Island, that is North America, Hitler, and the End of World War II, in which two cities would be destroyed by a gourd of ash falling from the sky, and that some of the spirits of the native people, because they believed in a form of reincarnation or a meme of reincarnation, would be born among the whites, and that these people would wear colors, beads, and feathers in their hair, and they would be close to the land and the earth and profess ecological values, and the name would be similar to Hopi, that is hippie. Now, this prophecy was inscribed in the stones that Hopi land in Arizona, and the prophecy was basically talked about in terms of, you know, being thousands of years before the coming of whites to Turtle Island. So, just like I said, Hopi or hippie. So, for example, Hopi represents the original mimetic culture, and hippie basically is a mimetic adaptation by white people attempting to emulate some of the cultural artifacts of the meme that can be observed. So it would be the language, would be the dress, would be the technology, would be a number of different things. So memes combine to form viral ideas which can mutate over time or given diverse environments. So a meme which once started as an indigenous Native American cultural construct then mutated when whites came and began to emulate it. And this basically just explains that. So white culture, for example, doesn't believe in reincarnation. The part of Hopi prophecy which holds that natives reincarnate as whites is not likely to be believed by white people and also some Native Americans whose culture has been erased. Thus, hippies simply become a way for whites to emulate the external values of Native culture in protest of the values of white culture. So these white 7-4 Hoover Crips were basically doing the same thing their grandparents were doing, except their grandparents might have become hippies. And actually, that's in fact what they said. Yeah, my grandma and grandpa is a hippie. My parents rebelled from being hippies. But, you know, we are going to become gang members because we don't believe that white culture is viable. White culture is whack. I mean, that's a direct quote for them. Right? So, two mimetic ways of seeing, which is true. So drug dealing gangs have been part of the United States for more than 150 years. The original gangs were ethnic Europeans who faced discrimination because they were not white. They were not considered white under the meme, i.e. white was exclusively white Anglo-Saxon Protestant. Catholics weren't considered white. And there was a whole issue about Catholics being under the dictate of a foreign power, i.e. the Pope in Rome. So white was defined as WASP, right? WASP then theorized the gang's criminality was part of their ethnic culture. That is Bohemians, Swedes, Dutch, Norwegians, Russians, Jews, Italians, those cultures were inherently criminal. That's why they got into gangs. This was the meme. Now, a meme, again, doesn't have to be true. It just has to conform to the logic of the belief, which is based on a lie. But this is the truth that people wanted to believe, and WASP put out this particular meme. So, for example, purposes for gangs from the scientific literature. Gangs arise from immigrant communities. Gangs arise as a rebellion against middle-class values. Gangs provide a deviant avenue to attain normal goals when young people are blocked in their efforts to seek material gain and or status through legitimate means, that is, law-abiding means, gangs. 1964, gangs attempt to sort out identity and gain peer group acceptance. So when we're talking about movies like West Side Story, which are the Sharks and the Jets are white, the Sharks are Puerto Rican, you know, there's a bit of racism within that, but also they're both in gangs, and they seek to create a group that meets their needs. 1972, gangs arise as a protest to counter bureaucratic cruelties of minority status. 1992, gang members come from families that experience greater poverty, substance abuse, chronic illness, and families involving involvement with the law, with law enforcement and corrections. Gangs provide what families cannot: affection, understanding, loyalty, recognition, and emotional and physical protection. Some gangs are multi-generational. This is from Morales in 1992. And basically I was taking that literature and saying, okay, there's a new paradigm in operation that y'all aren't recognizing, is the viral mimetic paradigm, which is basically, so developing a viral mimetic paradigm to explain white kids joining black style, LA style gangs, because the literature at the time didn't seem to take their involvement seriously. They, in fact, they were called wannabes for law enforcement, and basically the idea was that they were going to age out of it or join mainstream society, et cetera, which actually they didn't. And so now the gang problem in 2017 is white kids who've now been, who might have started out in black style gangs or LA style gangs, but now they come out of prison and basically maintain their criminal gang behavior. So why would white kids want to be black? So in any case, black street gangs arose out of a combination of reaction to racism, where the mainstream institutions were not protecting them and not acknowledging racism through assimilation. We cannot assimilate, as one black poet basically talked about, I am the bone in the melting pot that won't melt. Bones don't melt. So, the Slauson-backed black gangs formed to protect black citizens from the LAPD and the Spook Hunters, which was a white supremacist gang in LA who reinforced segregation. LAPD of the 1940s recruited from ex-militant, ex-military whites from the South and current Klan members in the South, conservative and racist. They did not screen them for Klan membership. In fact, they encouraged Klan membership. And so LAPD in Southern California was basically racist. This is not a new revelation or a paradigm, but just an acknowledged fact. So in fact, like Eugene, Klan membership was seen as a desirable quality and a good thing. The Slaussons became the core of, a street gang formed for self-defense, became the core of the Black Panthers, who then morphed into Crips, and the as US organization morphed into the Bloods. So gangs then became that grew into criminal organizations without the political social justice mimetic core that formed the Black Panthers and the US organization, so that they became criminal gangs, and so then the Crips and the Bloods became associated with criminal gangs, not, and criminality, not black social justice or social justice in general. So when we talk about then, again, mimetic engineering on a cultural medical context, and the reason that I'm basically spending this much time in mimetics is basically looking at what kind of cultural paradigm gets transmitted in the 1890s throughout the 20th century. So LA Crips and Bloods, Eugene and Omaha. So basically they form a mimetic cultural core, which is then emulated by Eugene and also Omaha. The reason I use the Omaha is that, for example, Time Magazine talked about the phenomenon that I had reported in Eugene, basically saying, here you have these white kids emulating black street gangs, except that they're mostly white within the gang context. They're forming mostly white gangs along this mimetic model. And Time Magazine featured one of those on the cover, and basically is a white kid wearing a white t-shirt and a baseball cap holding a sawed-off shotgun, and the cover identified him not as a gang member, but as a gunslinger. The Old West. So when you read the article, throughout the entire article, they're referring to the white kids as gunslingers. They're doing drive-bys, they're drinking 40s, they're basically, you know, beating people up and beating people into the gang, and they're living in mostly white neighborhoods, shooting at, you know, so again, drive-bys, drinking 40s, listening to rap music. The only time that the word gang is used is a street scene at night in which the two people of color sitting on the curb are being identified as gang members. The rest of the time, and so the caption of the picture, gang members being contacted by the police. The rest of the article talking about what would be called gang behavior, but it's not being called gang behavior because the kids are white, they are being referred to as gunslingers. All right? So this LA Crips and Bloods meme, the original gang got emulated by white kids, and law enforcement referred to them as wannabes, but they actually became more dangerous than the original black street gangs. And then that meme continued where you had Tongan and Samoan Crips and Bloods both on those islands and in places like Seattle where you would also have this gang behavior. So, and you also have Navajo Crips and Bloods too. So places where there are no black people, but the meme is transmitted and replicated anyway. So when I'm talking about a cultural viral mimetic paradigm, that is reporting what's actually happening on the ground and proposing a solution, or at least an example that you can generate a solution from. And so here's the solution. So viral ideas. So you have the meme. So for example, respect, juice, nation building, which are basically gang behaviors. So nation building, that is having sex with multiple women, getting them pregnant because you're going to die. You don't have a reasonable expectation of surviving, so you're going to basically carry on your line. Juice is basically your influence, your power. Respect is based on fear. You know, and acknowledging that your domination. So you take that viral idea and you expand it in the graphic, and so that you really inject what's called a pro-social meme. So instead of nation building, you basically inject the meme of safer sex, alcohol and other drug free sex, conscious sex, condom use, communication, HIV and hepatitis C infection protocols. So understanding that your partner might be infected and knowing the infection status of your partner. So countering that nation building meme. The idea of juice. Power is information. Patience, innovation, boldness, connections, to people and are being able to be articulate in your speech and writing and in your cultural products. Respect, knowledge of history, health of the community, self-respect, respecting yourself, self-actualization, having a sense of a bright and promising future, a continuum of force, basically understanding where that comes from, where you don't necessarily go to blows, you use your words rather than guns, and a code of honor. So mimetic engineering is basically taking that idea, taking those ideas and injecting them into the culture. So in order to inject pro-social memes into the gangs, you have to be culturally proficient, using the model of the meme of cultural competency. Cultural proficiency means being able to take artifacts from one culture and transfer them to another successfully. So, let's switch. From memes into straight up ethnic studies. All right, so the other day when we were talking about Lilly, what Obama signed into law, the Lilly Ledbetter law, it took until 2009 to install a legal remedy to the concept of equal work for equal pay for gender, because women made 78 cents on the dollar in the same type of job that men did, and there was no reason, and you know, women of color, then that was for white women, right? And then for women of color, they earned 62 cents on the dollar below white women and below white men. So basically creating a legal precedent so that you have gender pay equity. If women are doing the same work, they should get paid the same thing. So when we look at our country, wait, that the first time that happens is in 2009, and we started in 1776. That's slow progress and change. So not that we've eliminated for race yet, but there are internal remedies you can install before society catches up and gets over its dead historical ideas. So let's go there into those dead historical ideas because of the Niagara movement. So the other day when I was talking about American capitalism being based on the values of chattel slavery and that not all men are created equal and not all lives have equal worth. White lives matter more than black lives. That's why you have a protest movement called Black Lives Matter, because starting with the Constitution, white people are more valuable and are more valued than minorities, women, people of color. So, value, yes, you. So, if you've been systematically devalued, as a matter of course, that is, a system has educated you to believe that its core memes are true. True, okay? More true than your inner intrinsic worth or experience, and a system of imposed inequity has been presented as normal. Well, then you basically think about your place. Your place is basically inferior. And that's not what you experience internally. You feel that you have self-worth at some point in some core value. But the external world doesn't necessarily validate that. But you have this inner feeling that something is wrong, right? Okay, so then you have to reawaken and educate yourself. You might say, be woke. So part of the love your enemy meme, you know, that strategy meme In the original Aramaic language, it starts with self-love, and self-love is equated with self-knowledge. You have to know thyself, right? So self-love, self-healing, self-affirmation first. That's how you love your enemy. Then you find out what is the emptiness that is in your enemy, because your enemy becomes your enemy because of an emptiness or an envy that they feel. They don't love themselves. They don't validate their own self-worth. They basically, in a context where inequities are built into the system, basically where white supremacy comes from, if you analyze white supremacy from the point of view of white psychology, it's an inferiority complex. White people have to build themselves up and make themselves superior because they feel actually inferior to people of color. And people of color are going, no, we're equal. You're awesome too. It's not that we're awesome and you're not. We're not saying that. We're saying we're all awesome. So why do you feel that you have to be superior? Well, you're not superior, you're equal. And then white supremacists say, oh, you uppity Negro, or uppity N-word. That's the meme. An uppity nigger is a person that considers themselves equal or superior in some aspects to the white racist that's confronting them. Emmett Till died for that. You think you're equal to me? No, I think I'm better. So he got killed, right? So you're supposed to be inferior to the white supremacists, and you're supposed to know your place, that is, not assert your equality. So part of that self-love, then, and that self-healing, self-affirmation is part of the love your enemy. And it's the first thing that you need to do is basically affirm yourself and then see inside your enemy's heart where they don't feel that. And then in the emptiness that you can see and maybe they can't, you fulfill whatever it is that's missing in them. You don't actually even deal with them as an enemy, as an adversary. So that's part of the original instructions of love your enemy. So the African American experience is a counter meme to the traditional canon, a strategy meme for dealing with intersectional isms, that is, isms being individual, social, systemic mentalities. So individuals think of having a particular place based on what society tells them and the social structures tell them and reinforce a certain mentality, which, as we have been talking about, is a meme. The idea that memes create thought, meme is a virus of the mind representing certain thoughts, and sometimes you have to create a counter meme. So I'm not only talking about the African American experience being this class, I'm also talking about a successful praxis in countering intersectional, that is, race, gender, class, disability, and other forms of systemic discrimination. So systemic mentality. So it's an association meme to a larger, older tradition and body of knowledge that counters that and humanizes people. So here is a counter meme, a strategy meme, an association meme, Trojan horse and Nubian horse. So European history. The Trojan horse was a weapon disguised as a gift. A wooden horse, you know, so in the battle between the Greeks and Troy, the city of Troy, which is a walled city, the Greeks couldn't conquer it or couldn't attack it because they could retreat inside their wall and, you know, nobody could attack them. So this is in that movie Troy with Brad Pitt and some other folks. What that movie, of course, did not portray was the actual historical fact that there weren't just white people at Troy. But anyway, the Trojan horse was a weapon disguised as a gift, a wooden horse filled with soldiers who hid while the horse was dragged into the city of Troy. And the reason that they was dragged inside the city is that the Greek fleet had left and couldn't be seen wherever they were. So they figured, oh, these guys left a offering to the god Poseidon, a horse or whatever, and so they dragged the horse inside the city, and then at night, the Greek soldiers that were hidden inside the horse unlocked the gate, and the city of Troy was invaded, blah, blah, blah. So actual historical facts. So what is left out of the traditional canon is that there were black people defending Troy, fighting the Greeks. So, for example, in the Ethiopis, which is basically like the like Homer's Iliad, which is basically Odysseus's journey and all the other you know, Greek literature that you're supposed to study as part of your college education, there were black people defending Troy, fighting the Greeks. Memnon, who was leading what the Greeks called the Honorable Ethiopians, so they were clearly African, Ethiopian meaning land of the black faces, land of the burnt faces, and this is mentioned in the Ethiopis, which is basically a body of literature in which he's referred to, and Memnon was considered half mortal and half divine. He was the son of the dawn, Eos of the dawn, who, when after Memnon was killed by Achilles because he was fighting, his mother, the dawn, appealed to Zeus and said, you were supposed to make him immortal. So Zeus raised Memnon from the dead, and allegedly Memnon had other adventures beyond the Pillars of Hercules, which means here, Turtle Island, but that's another story. But I want to introduce the idea of a Trojan horse, a weapon disguised as a gift, and a Nubian horse, which is an African construct designed to both detect, neutralize Trojan horses. So Trojan horse has another cybernetic concept as malware or, you know, virus or whatever, same idea. It basically looks like it's benign, but it's actually not. So the idea, the basic meme, weapon disguised as a gift. The idea. And a Nubian horse, an African horse trained to recognize the weapon, diffuse it, and to turn it into something positive. So three tests. This is a maroon analysis about three tests that were brought to Indian country. So a Native American elder participating in the gathering of Native Americans, which I participated in. It was a federal training, four-day training about community organizing around substance abuse in Indian country. I worked in both the Native American one and the African American one because of my dual heritage. The African American one was called the I Am, Institute for African American Mobilization, and the GONA, Gathering of Native Americans. So a Native American elder basically said there were three tests that were brought to Indian people: the Bible, the bottle, i.e. alcohol, and the casino. Now, from a maroon, that is a first generation African and Native cultural hybrid, similar to mulatto, except more positive, right? So my Native heritage recognizes the wisdom that's inherent in this land and Native culture. My African heritage says, I need to kind of study history, because if there are three tests brought to a Native American by Europeans for conquest, because Europeans basically came here believing that all people of color in North America, North Central and South America, were agents of the devil. and they had to be eliminated. Sometimes converted to before eliminated, but that's what they believe. They were essentially carrying out the Crusades, basically on orders from the Pope and other people, right? So that was literally their belief, their mimetic belief. You know, these are heathens, these are the devil's work, they're doing the devil's work, so we're going to purify them. And three weapons disguised as gifts, though the natives didn't have that analysis, black people did. So as a maroon mimetic analysis, I said, okay, these three tests, the Bible, the bottle, the casino, are Trojan horses. Huh, okay. All right, the Bible. The King James Version of the Bible, the text of Western weaponized Christianity. So in other words, the original Bible, written in Aramaic, which is the language that Yeshua spoke, was written and devised in Africa. Christianity is an African religion with an African language text. The oldest book in the world, in the world, is an Egyptian Bible known as the Peshitta that dates back to 450 AD. The King James Version of the Bible dates back to 1550 or 1600, roughly, right, during King James. Now, the reason I call it weaponized is Yeshua, who you know by his Greek name Jesus, had no armies and killed no people, therefore no soldiers. How do you develop Christian soldiers, the meme of Christian soldiers? Well, Christian soldiers have to come from a text. That is the Bible, which is supposed to be the word of God. Does God want you to kill Indians and Africans and enslave Africans? That Bible is interpreted to say yes. That's why I mean weaponized. Okay, weaponized Christianity. So built from Greek, Latin, and Hebrew text, edited to support Western white expansion, genocide, ethnic cleansing, using an Aryan image of Jesus, and you, the Aryan meaning white, German, using this image to continue the Crusades, slavery, and genocide. That's what I mean by weapon disguised as a gift. It's a Trojan horse. The Bible, the bottle, the casino. So the oldest version of the Bible, the Peshitta in Aramaic, the language that Yeshua Isho spoke, the text of the Eastern Church, which still speaks Aramaic today, and never engaged in the Crusades, slavery, conquest, genocide, ethnic cleansing, with the image of a Yeshua as a man of color. So if you haven't heard of that, that's still in effect today. The Aramaic-speaking Christians have not engaged in warfare up until Daesh or ISIS began slaughtering Christians. And then they started fighting back. But until then, they didn't engage in any of the things of the Western Church, all right? So that meme, that counter meme, that is the truth, the reality of the origins of Christianity and the practices of Christ. So when I said love your enemies from the Aramaic, it's instructions on how to do it. It talks about nothing about turning the other cheek, nothing about that at all. But it does mean that you love yourself through self-knowledge and you love your enemy by knowing your enemy better than your enemy knows themselves. And that your enemy is your only your enemy because they don't know who they are. They don't know their unity. That's why Yeshua was able to say on the cross, "Forgive them, for they know not what they do." Right? Which is not necessarily an attitude that I would have being crucified. But anyway. Okay. Bible, the bottle, the casino. Okay? Though unknown, this becomes the text for Black liberation theology, the meme, Trojan horse warfare, weapons disguised as gifts. The Bible erases indigenous spirituality for colonized religion. The Willie Lynch letter and Lynch them. Trojan horse, basically the smallpox blankets, the weaponized Christianity, the King James Version of the Bible, rather than the, using the Peshitta, even if it's only in interpretation. So to use the gift of the Bible as a Nubian horse, you have to diffuse the weapon, recognize the toxic memes and their effects on you, and then you can use the gift. Because at its core, its mimetic core, in its original context and of the acculturation, what became the Christian religion was as an effective tool of human liberation and equity against Roman oppression. And the kingdom of heaven was a group of practitioners like Christ who could carry out that the liberation of the nation of Israel. That was the idea, not an army to kill people before after converting them. Like Aztec babies were baptized before being killed by the Spaniards, right? So the weapon destroys your relationship to yourself and then to others. So connection to knowledge is the mimetic cure, the Nubian horse. The guru in you, G-U means dispeller of darkness, R-U, bringer of light. So Nubian horse brings knowledge, brings self-knowledge to basically work against the Trojan horse. Sankalpa birds say, go back and fetch it. So what if it doesn't exist back then? You have to now create it now or from the future. How do you create something from the future? Well, you imagine it. And then you bring that into being. Sometimes you have to go back to the future. So, for example, coming out of the gay 90s, okay, where there were between 1884 and 1899, 1,700 lynchings. And I will actually describe a lynching in particular, but suffice to say, it was a racial act carried out by mostly white people against mostly black people, though some white people were lynched as well, Jews. We've got to create an international movement to change the conditions because maybe America doesn't have the solutions we need. Now, partially, America does if you look at indigenous people of color having indigenous models of democracy. So there's a film called Ethnic Notions. So see, I would highly recommend it. Marlon Riggs, the same name, Ethnic Notions. So psychologically speaking, an archetype is a deep psychological structure coined by Carl Jung, Western psychology. Jung thought that archetypes were symbolic. So archetypes are common to all people or a particular people, internal to the culture, that is emic to the culture. So for example, in African and Native psychology, archetypes aren't just symbols, they are actually real and reflective of realities and history. So they're not just images or symbolic, they represent actual natural spiritual forces. So there is a Guinea jungle fowl, which is one of the ancestors of what's called the modern chicken. So Guinea jungle fowl in Africa. And this is a picture of one. So if chickens are actually native, well, I mean, they came, in terms of evolution, they were here before humans were. And there are, in many places over the planet, there are an indigenous chicken variation. There's chickens in India, chickens in Russia, chickens in Europe, chickens in South America and America. Okay, but the image of the modern chicken is a variation of the jungle waterfowl. Watermelon. You see, you guess where I'm going now, right? So watermelon is a vine-like flowering plant originally from southern Africa. Its fruit, which is also called watermelon, is a special kind referred to by botanists as a pepo, a berry which has a thick rind and fleshy center. Now, the reason that I'm talking about archetypes and stereotypes, all right? So an archetype in an African context is we created watermelons. We first cultivated and grew watermelons. So the idea, and we also invented agriculture and cooking with oil, which is basically squeezing the seeds of various plants and squeezing the oil out of them, and therefore having discovered fire, having discovered iron, et cetera, fried chicken and watermelon is a stereotype based on an archetype where, yeah, black people actually had, well, one of many people that, you know, cultivated both chickens, domesticated chickens, and watermelon. So yeah, we would eat chickens and watermelon, fried chicken and watermelon, for thousands of years. And we weren't the only ones to do that. Indians, that is, you know, the dot Indians, not the feather Indians, Indians of India also had very many recipes for fried chicken and chicken curry, et cetera, like I said. Chickens were nearly planet-wide, and watermelons came from Africa, right? So, a stereotype is an external observation and generalization from outside of the culture, often negative, but based on a cognitive structure in the brain. Basically, stereotypes is basically a shortcut to avoid thinking deeply, because sometimes you can't think deeply about a situation, you have to make quick decisions. So, the archetype is, yes, we created chicken, cooked various ways, and we created watermelon. So the stereotype, that's an archetype, that's a reality. The stereotype of black people eating fried chicken and watermelon, used as a negative stereotype, is based on the actual archetype, but it wasn't negative to us because we recognize a part of the historical reality, or at least this class is talking about the historical reality. Now, outside of the culture, by white supremacists, basically eating fried chicken and watermelon is seen as a sign of ignorance or inferiority. So here's some of the stereotypes promoted by in advertising. So, General Electric, screen right. Your next range should be a General Electric. And so you have a black person eating fried chicken. Below them, Sambo, eating watermelon. The brand of watermelon. Screen right. Not a black stereotype, but do you eat fried chicken? Asking that of Obama, the former president, but still current president. $10 Obama bucks. Fried chicken, Kool-Aid, watermelon. So, stereotypes are a type of meme that can be countered with counter memes But you can't talk about post-racial America. Racism is very much in effect. Aunt Jemima, happy fine. Aunt Jemima pancakes. Show sets folks singing. Aunt Jemima says. And basically, this is a reference from Gawker, which I'm going to skip over because of time somewhat. So, Aunt Jemima got a makeover in the 21st century, and I think this. So, this was the traditional image, the happy mammy, that is the black domestic serving white people. And then Aunt Jemima, she, you know, loses the do-rag, gets a set of earrings, and gets a hairdo. And gone is the servile clothing. Same thing with Uncle Ben, who literally was actually a rice grower that two white men basically decided to use as a model for a particular brand of rice. Uncle Ben was a rice grower in Texas, and so he was neither of the white men's uncle, but uncle and aunt was in slavery times a reference to elderly black people who were called uncle if they were male and aunt if they were female, in terms of because of their close relationship with the slave owner's family. But again, this was slavery. You weren't actually an aunt or an uncle, and you also could be sold. So the idea of Uncle Tom's Cabin. Uncle Tom was a slave who helped other slaves escape and was killed for it, but the reason he was called Uncle Tom was because of his age, not because of any biological relationship. And this rebranding just from Uncle Ben to Uncle Ben being a waiter serving rice and then being a CEO in the same company, this is part of the rebranding. So in Diversity TV, when we were basically talking about Aunt Jemima and artist Wendy Hune's work, here you have a cartoon duck dressing up like Aunt Jemima. And so when we talked about, okay, yeah, you can use art to provoke a reaction, provoke and instruct people, but you should at least have a context statement about acknowledging that Aunt Jemima is not necessarily considered a good role model, but a kind of racist stereotype holding from slavery. So her dressing, you know, a duck as Aunt Jemima was not considered neutral. Neither was the other things where she created what was called a pickaninny. And so when we talk about pickaninnies, which came from the Spanish pequeño niño, which means little children, which means is a term applied, another ethnic slur like nigger or tar baby applied to black slaves. They were little children considered less than. Here you have a pickaninny eating watermelon. And more of Ms. Hune's art, not a job for grown-ups, using a pickaninny. And then here you have a pickaninny. This piece of art is called Eat. So you have a pickaninny in a grass skirt next to a devil, boiling a European man in a cauldron. So whatever this is saying, the way it was taken when it was displayed here at LCC in the art gallery, there were a number of people who were offended by this. And Miss Hune basically said, you know, when I contacted her and others people contacted because people wanted to write, you know, rip down her art, she basically said, well, these figures, this Pickaninny figures, I didn't know them as a Pickaninny figure. These were what I called Huggies. We got them at gas stations when we got gas in the 50s, which I was alive in the 50s, so they weren't giving them out in LA, so I don't know about this Huggy thing, but nonetheless, it looks like a Pickaninny, pretty much. And so if you're going to use it in your art, could you please put a context statement about this image was used in for a long time, and basically just like from the time of blackface. I mean, so blackface was offensive, pickaninnies were offensive, tar babies were offensive, same culture generating the offense and still having that same power today. So when we talk about memes being translated through cultural language and have taking on different meanings, we still have to be aware of those meanings, and we'll take this up more next week. Thank you for your attention. Oh, one other thing. The liberate, go to slide. So black people use that too. This is a Nubian horse. This is the liberation of Aunt Jemima. So in addition to a broom, she also has a shotgun for revolution. And the film Bamboozled by Spike Lee. So you should also check that film out because it also talks about the context of blackface as well. So Jim Crow was a fictional person representing what we call type 4 legal discrimination. And we'll explore this more in the coming weeks. Till then, stay strong. Get out of here.